The Kazukian Network presents Riffin' on Jazz with your host, Howard Robertson and Malvin Massey.
Sonny Rollins.
You got to improve, man. You got Coltrane and Ornette Coleman and these boys coming up. You better get your stuff together.
Mr. Miles Davis.
White people are funny. They, in America, they thought that I just woke up one morning and had the blues and started playing the trumpet. But it don't go like that, and you can't explain that to them.
Miles was able to make something that was wrong into something that was right.
Now they know. I'm not an accident.
Riffin' on Jazz.
Hello and welcome back to Riffin' on Jazz. I'm Howard Robertson.
And I'm Malvin Massey, and this is Riffin' on Jazz, your weekly visit with friends talking about the music we love.
That classic African-American art form called jazz. Malvin!
Mr. Robertson.
Hey, man. Oh, I'm Mr. Robertson.
What?
You Malvin, I'm Mr. Robertson.
You're the executive, right? Yeah. So we go with that.
Look, man, great show last week. Great show. Hip-hop sampled my jazz.
I got a couple of compliments about that.
Yeah, man. I got a lot of
several
feedback,
people talking about it.
Got a lot of feedback. And for those of you who want to go back and listen to any of our past shows, it's very, very easy to do. You can pull up the podcast on iTunes, Google Play, or Stitcher. Just simply search, Riffin' on Jazz.
Riffin' on Jazz, yeah.
And on YouTube, you got to do something special. YouTube, go to YouTube and search Kazukian Media. Now, that's spelled K-U-D-Z-U-K-I-A-N Media. And all of our shows will come up on YouTube. Listen to them when you're working out. Listen to them when you're on the drive, when you're on a trip. It's good stuff.
You can pull it up on YouTube, too.
Right.
Just
right.
Put in Kazukian Network.
Kazukian Media.
Media.
Or Kazukian Network, whatever.
Yeah.
Whatever.
It works. Because ain't no other Kazukians around.
This is true. Larry Robinson knew what he did. He had very, very unique branding.
Original
and
guy.
Knew that the woods were not full of Kazukian anything.
A very, very wise man.
But we've got a great show today. Today we're going to be talking about great vibes of jazz.
Yeah.
Great vibes of jazz. So what are we talking about? We're talking about vibraphonists.
Yeah.
People who play vibes. And before we get into that, first thing we got to do is some definition, Malvin, because so many people don't understand what vibes are. Vibes are not xylophones. It's not a marimba. It's different.
Yeah.
And it's a new instrument. Everything else in jazz groups are instruments that are hundreds of years old.
The newest one at the time when the vibes came in was a saxophone.
Well, no, it was one newer than that. And that's electric pianos.
I'm talking about in the 20s and stuff.
Oh.
I'm talking about back in the day, way back.
Oh, I know. Saxophones
saxophone,
go way
you
back.
Know, Sidney Bechet went to France and brought saxophone, the soprano saxophone.
Okay, back. The soprano.
But that was all he had
but
at the time.
But they had the curb, right?
He didn't get the curb. The one he brought back didn't have a curb. It was over in France before everybody, he was using clarinets and stuff.
But the vibe is a young instrument.
The vibe started in 1921.
Right. And so what's the difference between vibes and a marimba?
Okay, well, you know, I Googled it.
You always do.
The vibraphone resembles the xylophone, marimba, and glockenspiel.
Right.
Each bar is paired with a resonator tube that has a motor-driven butterfly valve at the upper end. The valves are mounted on a common shaft, which produces a tremolo or vibrato effect while spinning, and the vibraphone has its sustained pedal similar to that on the piano. With the pedal up, the bars are damped and it produces a shortened sound. The pedal down, the sound is several seconds longer.
Okay, now I'm gonna break all of that down for y'all. Vibes, the thing that sets them apart from a marimba or a xylophone is it's got a motor.
Yeah.
And it's got a sustained pedal. So it's plugged into the wall. And that's how it gets the tone and the sustain and all of that. Yeah. So we are going to go into the great vibist of all time. And we're going to begin with the original one. His name is Lionel Hampton.
Thank you.
That was Flying Home by Lionel Hampton.
Yeah.
Lionel Hampton is the godfather of the vibes.
Yeah.
But he began playing drums.
Yeah, that's what I heard. At least that's what I've read about him in the bio.
Right,
yeah,
right,
yeah.
Right. Born in our producer's hometown of Louisville, Kentucky. And I think when he was very, very young, they moved back down to his mother's hometown, which was Birmingham, Alabama. Mm-hmm. And so he kind of grew up all over the place, but raised by a single mother, and expressed or showed some interest in music at a very, very young age. But as I said, began as a drummer.
Yeah.
Began as a drummer and found the vibes in a most unusual way.
Yeah,
right.
So I was looking at the NPR. The NPR did especially a little while ago about it, and I looked in at the NPR site. So it goes. It says the legend goes like this: in 1930, jazz drummer Lionel Hampton was performing a gig at NBC Studios. In those days, and for a long time to come, the sound that identified NBC was three
dun,
notes:
dun, dun.
G-E-C. And on the vibraphone. So naturally, there was a vibraphone in the studio. After his gig was over, Hamp started messing with the instrument and became fascinated by it. Shortly thereafter, Hampton brought the vibes, as the instrument is now commonly called, to a recording session with Louis Armstrong. Their version of Memories of You is the first known jazz recording to incorporate the vibraphone. Jazz has been using the vibes like crazy ever since.
Ever since, ever since. And that was very, very early on. And mm-hmm. As we mentioned earlier, the instrument itself had only been established in the early 20s.
Yeah.
In the early 20s, so it was a very, very young instrument. But he went on, obviously, to make a name for himself. And one thing I want to mention, he was playing in Los Angeles. And somebody brought Benny Goodman to see him. And Benny Goodman said, oh, nah, I gotta have you. So he became part of the Benny Goodman Quartet with Teddy Wilson, Gene Krupa, and Benny Goodman and Lionel Hampton. He said about Benny Goodman, as far as I'm concerned, what he did in those days, and they were hard days in 1937, made it possible for Negroes to have their chance in baseball and other fields. That's what he said. They were the first integrated jazz group to play
anywhere
for public audiences.
They had a trip.
Isn't that wild?
Yeah, that's really cool. That's really cool. Jazz, again, being a catalyst.
But he was a consummate showman, a great front man. You couldn't have, and his band was always stocked. Off the chain with extremely talented musicians.
As a matter of fact, they said he was something like Art Blakey.
Right, right,
you know,
at
least with the guys that played with him anyway.
Absolutely. You came through, you earned your stripes playing with Lionel Hampton.
As a matter of fact, just on a little aside, the track that we just played off of there, Flying Home, is not on a Lionel Hampton CD, if you're looking for it. It's on an Illinois Jacket CD, and it's called Black Velvet Band, and the idea being that at the Newport Jazz Festival in
67,
both bands were playing. Illinois Jacket had his own band. Lionel Hampton had his band there, but being an alum of Lionel Hampton's band, they put him in there and played Flying Home.
Right, right, right.
And it's one of the most famous recordings attributed to Lionel Hampton.
And we're going to segue and transition from Hamp to Bags.
Yeah.
Who is Bags? Bags is a cat named Milt Jackson, who came along right after Lionel Hampton, and I was obviously influenced heavily by Lionel. Yeah. And Milt Jackson just brought cool to the, and let me say this. We're talking about vibes. We always talk about sounds that are pleasing to the ear.
Yeah.
And vibes sound nice, sound just pretty.
Always elegant. You know,
they do.
George Shearing with that sound that he picked up.
Right.
What's the name, Himes?
Playing in unison together with the piano. But we're going to get into Milt Jackson, and then we're going to come back and talk a little bit.
Thank you.
Milt Bags Jackson.
Yeah.
Very, very cool. Very, very cool sound.
That old Devil Moon.
Right,
that was
right,
from
right.
Goodbye.
And Milt Jackson was, again, a pioneer of vibes. Started life in Detroit, Michigan. And, you know, he was a, they call what he played everything. He played every genre. He played hard bop. He played Afro-Cuban. He played modal. He played mainstream. And they got him as post-bop. But you know something, Malvin?
What is that, man?
He played so cool. So I don't know how you can eliminate cool jazz from his repertoire of genres.
Yeah, he was
right
there.
How do you do that?
He was right there at the time.
Absolutely.
You know, that's what he was doing. He was... He had that elegant sound, that MJ, the Modern Jazz Quartet, MJQ.
Right.
That was the, it was like Dave Brubeck. And that cool sound. Milt Jackson could do that, you know.
And Milt Jackson started out life just as, we should say vibes is a percussion instrument.
Right.
So Lionel Hampton started out as a drummer, another percussion instrument. But, Milt Jackson started out as a piano player.
Yeah.
Which is what? Also,
a percussion instrument.
Also a percussion instrument. Keyboard's a percussion instrument. So, he started out playing keyboards, and he is known for the harmonics and technique that a lot of other vibe players.
They hadn't recognized at the time.
No,
but
no.
There weren't that many either. There were some, but there really weren't any real.
Lionel Hampton had started it out.
Hampton started it, but I mean, so then came the next cat in line was Bags.
Yeah, yeah.
It wasn't that much competition at the time.
How did he get the nickname Bags?
Some cat, they just said some musician in Detroit called him, nicknamed him Bags, called the Bags on his eyes.
So when we say Bags, you know we're talking about Milt Jackson. In 1952, something very, very seminal happened. He started MJQ, the Modern Jazz Quartet.
Yeah.
Now, if you want to hear some cool jazz, listen to anything that Modern Jazz Quartet, absolutely.
Yeah.
Anything that's got MJQ on it.
Included Ray Brown.
Right.
Playing bass. Kenny Clarke was in that band.
Right.
John Lewis.
Right.
Yeah.
So, as we move forward, we're going to talk about another guy that is very, very special in this scheme of things, Gary Burton.
Yeah.
And we're going to get into more after this. Thank you. And that was Cato's Revenge from his Face to Face album, Gary Burton.
Yeah, with Makoto Ozonio, killer keyboard player from Japan.
Gary Burton, Indiana guy, born in Indiana, taught himself to play marimba and vibraphone. I don't know if the vibraphones
They're just hanging around.
Nah. So I don't know where he found one, but he did, and he taught himself to play. And he cites Bill Evans as one of his major influences, which is why I think he can play so cool. And he mastered the two mallet technique. Now, let me explain to everybody. It's a total of four mallets. He got two hands, and he's got two mallets in each hand.
And everybody else played with one mallet at a time.
Right, you know? Which means that he can play chords.
Yeah.
Okay, he can play chords with his, and so I think he was the first, he was the pioneer.
He was the first one that did that, you know. And now Andy Norell and those guys use four mallets on a steel pan drum. That came from Gary Burton, too.
Right, routinely. Went to Berklee College of Music and
came out of Nashville, as a matter of fact, too.
Tell him about that. Tell him who he played with.
He played with Hank Garland and Chet Atkins.
Yes.
Of all people. He mixed, so they were saying Bags mixed one set of sounds into it. And this cat mixed in the sound of country, of rock, of classical.
Mm-hmm.
He mixed all these sounds together with keeping jazz in it.
Right.
He played with George Shearing and Stan Getz, too. George Shearing and Stan Getz.
Played fusion. I mean, played with Chick Corea, played with Pat Metheny, Roy Haynes. So he has had a tremendous career that still goes on because right now, where is he?
He is the executive vice president responsible for overseeing daily operations at the Berklee College of Music in Boston.
At Berklee. He's an administrator at Berklee and keeping the tradition alive. So that's fantastic. Also a very complex guy, which you will hear in this interview. Leads a different lifestyle, and we're going to listen to that and be back on the other side of a break with more Riffin' on Jazz.
Yeah.
When I came out publicly, officially, in 1994 in an interview with Terry Gross on NPR, she asked me what it was like being a gay jazz musician. And I gave this statement that I was a musician who happened to be gay. I've been now a more fully out gay person in all these years since then, and it's safe to say I feel it's the opposite. I'm a gay guy who happens to be a jazz musician. And I describe it that way because I don't think about music every waking moment. I do lots of things during the day, and some days I hardly think about the music at all because I'm not working that day or playing that day. But I'm always aware that I'm gay. I'm always aware of my sexual identity. So I think that's, you know, the way it should be phrased, that I'm a gay person. I always was gay. I didn't figure it out until I was in my 40s. But once I finally got it clear, that's been a major part of my, my identity and who I am.
Riffin' on Jazz.
We're riffin' on jazz.
Hey, this is your guy, DC. Funky Politics, we're back. A brand new season, brand new shows, brand new guests. We're going to do it just right, right here on the Kadukian Network.
Artivism, Best in Blue, Funky Politics, Blues in the Basement, Neighborhood Connect, Riffin' on Jazz, on the Kadukian Network.
Riffin' on Jazz.
Welcome back to Riffin' on Jazz. So, we have heard from the old masters.
Yeah.
Now we're going to get into a younger one. His name is Stephon Harris. And upstate New York kid, Albany, New York.
Yeah.
And he started apparently playing vibes from the start.
Yeah, it looks like that. I mean, I was looking to see if he played piano or something like that first, like a lot of people did. All I can find is that he started playing vibes and marimba.
Right.
But he started playing classical music.
He studied classical music.
Yeah, he studied classical music with a vibraphone.
All right. So that says that young Stephon is on some material and can read music like a banshee.
Yeah, that tripped me out. Because even the bios and stuff about the vibraphone say it's mostly used for jazz. But,
right.
You know, it has those elements, and I suppose it replaced bells.
Yeah. And he was in the Empire State Youth Orchestra and went to the Manhattan School of Music and is a very, very accomplished at young age of 44. Is a very, very accomplished young man with 6 CDs to his credit.
And guys on the CDs that he's played with and had played with him, like Kenny Barron, mm-hmm. Steve Therese, mm-hmm. backed up Kurt Elling,
yeah.
And Charlie Hunter.
A classic jazz singer.
Yeah.
But really, really thoughtful and heady young guy, as you will hear in a recent interview where, you know, he talks about all kind of stuff in terms of influences and whatnot. But Stephon Harris is also a tremendous player.
The Los Angeles Times called him one of the most important young artists in jazz.
And he has started a group called the Classical Jazz Quartet. Not to be confused with the Modern Jazz Quartet. But let's hear a little bit about the background of Stephon Harris.
Well, it's interesting. I actually didn't grow up playing jazz. I grew up with what I would call the culture of jazz. But in terms of hearing Charlie Parker or Thelonious Monk, I didn't hear any artists like that until I was in college. My mother's a Pentecostal minister, so I grew up in the black culture and in the black church. And many of the cultural manifestations that come out in jazz are embodied in the church experience as well, and outside of the church. This idea of individual expression, that it's not just about copying and reiterating sounds from the past. When you stand up in church and you sing, even if you're out of tune, the congregation's gonna say, "That's all right, baby." You get a certain level of support, and it's never that you're just copying other people around. It's about you telling a story. So I can remember sister such and such standing up and saying, you know, last week my brother was sick, and I want to let you know I really appreciate that everybody's been praying for him, and I want to tell you today that he's feeling better. And all of a sudden, the chord would just come in. and it would be just the right chord based on the emotion of what was happening in that moment. And then as she kept talking, the drums would start joining, and then the bass and the so the music was there to serve the story that was being told. And I think my introduction into music from church music to soul music like Stevie Wonder, it just was always about the music being used for something greater than just playing the right chord changes.
That would be Stefan Harris, Brown Bell Blues from the 90 Miles CD.
He did that down in Cuba.
Recorded in Cuba.
90 miles away.
All right. So we're staying with some of the young cats. We're staying with some of the young guns. And that brings us to probably the youngest, Warren Wolf. Yeah.
He was going to school in 97.
Right.
He was in high school in 97.
Yesterday. Yeah. Last week.
Yeah.
Warren Wolf, Baltimore School of the Arts, trained in vibes, marimba, drums, and piano. Yeah. Where did he go to college?
He went to Berkeley. And he studied under Dave Samuels. And we know Dave Samuels for vibes and steel pan drums. It's Dave Samuels taught Warren Wolf.
It all comes around. Yeah. So let's get into some Warren Wolf. Yeah.
And the thing about this kid is that he plays such a beautiful vibe.
And it's a beautiful song called Emily. Thank you. Warren Wolf with a beautiful rendition of Emily.
Yeah, Johnny Mercer's Immortal.
Absolutely.
Gorgeous tune. And the reason we did that was simply because he plays such a gorgeous vibraphone.
He does, he does.
But he deserved that gorgeous song.
But I don't want anybody to get it twisted.
Oh, no.
I don't want
no.
anybody to get it twisted. He plays real sensitively and gorgeously, but he's an avid weightlifter.
And
Warren Wolf will body slam your butt. You hear me?
Plus, he
got five kids.
Yeah, he got a lot of children.
So, got a lot of children. So,
Facey, you didn't even have to bring that up.
Don't get it messed up now.
No.
Look, we cannot go any further. We do this show based in Memphis, Tennessee. The heart and soul and foundation and anchor of all music. Yeah. All music. All American music. All right? So we can't go any further without talking about a couple of vibes, one in particular.
Yeah. Well, now, Ronnie, and I'm trying to remember if it's Ronnie Williams or Ronnie Johnson.
It wasn't what Ronnie Williams. It must have been Johnson.
Ronnie. But he played vibes. When I played with Pug at Hawaii Now, Ronnie used to come sit in with us. He played vibes. And he played vibes all over the town, and he did private parties and stuff like that.
Right, right.
He was the only vibe player that I knew in town at the time.
But I didn't know him, but I did know this one. Another musician, consummate musician, and a lot of people don't realize was also a pretty tremendous vibraphonist, was none other than Isaac Hayes.
Isaac Hayes
was a multi-instrumentalist, and he played, of course, everybody knows he played keyboards and whatnot, but he also played alto sax.
Yeah.
And he played vibes. And he played vibes no better ever in his life than he did on this particular cut coming up.
From 1971.
The movie Shaft, from the soundtrack of the movie Shaft. I think it's called Ellie's Love Song, or Ellie's Love Theme.
Yeah.
Thank you.
are listening to Riffin' on Jazz with Howard and Malvin. And we want to make sure you continue to listen to Riffin' on Jazz. First thing we want you to do is to tell somebody. Tell somebody about this show, this very, very cool show that deals with jazz and that learns you something.
Yeah. And the cool part about it is that we're learning too.
Yeah,
as we absolutely go along, we're learning about these things too.
This is the kind of information, this, I want you to know this. This is how we learned about jazz. The way we learned about jazz is because somebody older, our dads, our uncles, or somebody
Mr.
in
Thomas,
the music, yeah, band directors and whatnot, set us down and made us do two things. They made us listen. They made us do one main thing. They made us listen.
Yeah.
And listen to the music and listen to the information. They gave us background and whatnot on the music, and we're just trying to maintain that. So we'd like for you to catch our past shows by going to iTunes, going to Google Play, going to Stitcher, and just put in Riffin' on Jazz. And our past shows will come up, and you can listen to them at your convenience, or go to YouTube. Go to YouTube and search for Kudzukian Media, K-U-D-Z-U-K-I-A-N Media, and all of our shows will come up. Rate them, subscribe, and all that. If you subscribe, you'll get them all the time.
Right. And so, you pull it up on YouTube, on our TuneIn radio.
Right. Tune, yeah, absolutely. Tune in when we air in Memphis on WUMR Friday nights at 7 p.m.
Right on.
All kind of ways you can get to it. So please do. And tell somebody. We are going to talk. We're talking about vibraphonists, and we can't go any further without. We talked about him in last week's
and
show.
That was the thing. You know, it's like, okay, are we going to hit Roy Ayers again? But we just couldn't help it.
No, you know? I mean, so because he's such a classic and consummate vibraphonist. And but we're going to deal with a different Roy Ayers.
Going to dispel the what do they call it, the model of Roy Ayers. What everybody thinks of Roy Ayers.
Misperception.
Yeah,
that that only he's only acid jazz or all the latter stuff he did. What we're about to play, is classic straight ahead Roy Ayers, to let you know and to show you that this man had some chops and could absolutely play. This is a 23-year-old Roy Ayers, and
he's just coming off of playing with major players and stuff.
Totally. Yeah. And he is doing Days of Wine and Roses off of his West Coast Vibes album of 1963.
His first release. Thank you.
That's right. That's right. Days of Wine and Roses, young Roy Ayers.
When he was still playing straight ahead jazz.
Totally, man. Totally.
You're listening to Riffin' on Jazz on the Kudzukian Network.
We're riffin' on jazz.
I'll play the blues for you.
Blues in the Basement with Stephanie and T. Shaw.
Some great festivals going on around the tri-state area.
Got your dancing shoes?
Man, as long as I'm with you, baby, I'm always be on my toes.
Drop that zero.
Bring your blues, boo.
I got him.
We'll see you.
Let me go home.
Get set for an all-new season of Blues in the Basement, coming soon to the Kudzukian Network.
Rolling down the street with my radio on, listen to Funky Politics.
The mayor of the city of Memphis, Mayor Jim Strickland. How are you, sir?
Fantastic. We keep it real, we keep it right, and we keep it funky.
Get set for an all-new season of Funky Politics, coming soon to the Kudzukian Network.
Artivism, best in blue, funky politics, blues in the basement, neighborhood connect, riffin' on jazz, on the Kudzukian Network.
We're riffin' on jazz.
We're going back and forth. We're going back to the masters, and we're going back to the younger guys.
Yeah.
And since this guy that we're talking about is about our age, he's one of the younger guys, right?
Yeah. Well, I would say that. I mean, yeah, he's born, he's the same age as my brother, Cliff. He was born in 54. And the reason that I know him so well is because he's played with all the local, Mug Room Miller, Donald Brown.
Right.
It, you know, you see these guys, CDs, and you see the vibraphone, you see Steve Nelson.
Steve Nelson.
On the disc with him.
Steve Nelson, graduate of, a native of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, graduate of Rutgers University, taught at Princeton for a time, but has played with David Fathead Newman, Kenny Barron, Mulgrew Miller, and a host of others.
Yeah, as I was saying, Mulgrew CDs will always have Steve Nelson on. Steve Nelson will have Mulgrew, or Don, or back before he died, James Williams.
Mm-hmm.
These cats, they were like contemporaries.
Love that Memphis connection.
Yeah, they were contemporaries. As a matter of fact, when we were going to have Radiothon concert, I called Don to be the music.
Right.
He said, okay, I'll put the band together. And one of the cats he was calling was Steve Nelson.
That's you know, it. That's it. Steve Nelson from the Sound Effects LP.
Yeah.
Riffin' on Jazz.
On Jazz.
On Jazz.
On Jazz.
Why did you choose jazz as a career?
My good friend Herbie Lewis, we were in junior high school. And Herbie played bass and he had a trio. I told Herbie, I'll buy a vibraphone. He says, you know, if you buy a vibraphone, you can play in a trio and we'll have a quartet. And we'll be like the modern jazz quartet. He says, and you can play, you can make money and meet girls. I said, ooh, that sounds good. Herbie says, Bobby, we have a concert in 2 weeks. And I had just got the instrument. I can't play a concert in 2 weeks. I know nothing. He says, I'll take a felt pencil and write down which bar on the vibraphone for you to hit next as we play the song. So I said, okay. My mom was the proudest lady in the world. That's my boy, he's gonna go. He just started playing and he's a genius already. Watch what's gonna happen. Well, we got out there and we got ready to play the concert. And the stage manager walks up to him and he says, okay, kids, you're on next. He says, oh, by the way, Bobby, I saw a bunch of stuff written all over your bars and I took a wet towel and wiped everything off. I said, oh, no, you didn't. He says, yes, I did. Now, he says, now get out there and play. And my heart went boom, 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 and the curtain opened up. And I think I hit the first note. And then after that was complete chaos. And all the kids at school started laughing and going crazy and yelling boo. But my mom was sitting there out there in front. And she had this thing. She says, that's my boy. She gave me the strength to get up off the mat after being floored like that and keep going. If I died right now, I'd want to have people know when they hear my record being played, they can say, that's Bobby Hutcherson playing. It's important to have that signature.
Truly one of the great innovators of jazz vibes, Mr. Bobby Hutcherson.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I'm loving this. I'll say it again. I'm loving this. I'm loving going back and forth between the old and the new, which let everybody know that Jazz Vibes has a legacy that's still being continued.
Yeah, because Hutch was like a continuation into the 60s, mm-hmm. but then he kept going. And the thing about him was, we were talking about the other day, that Bobby Hutcherson sort of made vibe jazz cool. Always was cool. You know what I mean?
Right.
But he was like
I thought.
Yeah, but he was like the James Bond of it.
Okay.
You know, it was
like, you
know, hey, we're listening to Bobby Hutcherson, you know? Okay. Okay. It was one of those kind of things, man.
It's what you like. Lucky for you, that's what you like. You like the champagne or excuse me, not the champagne. Not the champagne. Yeah. It's what?
This cool wine that Larry got. I don't know what that is.
And a cigarette.
Yeah.
All out of the 60s.
That's right.
But yeah, he ushered that in and certainly one of the innovators. As compared to, he was one of the young guns as compared to a Lionel
And Mill Jackson.
Mill Jackson.
Even Garrett Burton.
Garrett Burton, yeah. He was
younger than him.
But fantastic player and innovator, as I said. I mean, you know, all of these guys, they set the standard for, and continue with the younger ones to set the standards for jazz vibraphonists.
Yeah, Bobby Hutcherson was with Eric Dolphy. Eric Dolphy, Archie Shepp, and Herbie Hancock. They were all contemporaries right there in the same time. They were changing music around. And Bobby included the vibes in that with the same idea that he also could make it so cool.
and vibes sound cool anyway.
Yeah.
You know,
to me,
they do.
The elegant thing. It's an elegant sound.
And, well, I think it gets more elegant when they are played in unison with piano.
Like George Shearing.
Yeah. I mean, that you don't get more elegant than that.
You know, there's a CD around here in Memphis right now, Renee Koopman with Tim Goodwin and Larry Gooch. And Renee Koopman's playing piano and vibes. Tim Goodwin is playing electric bass and something else, and Larry Gooch playing drums.
Mm-hmm.
And they
are playing in unison.
Playing in unison, and they're doing it in the style of George Shearing.
That's good beautiful.
CD. Renee Koopman.
Beautiful. Great vibes of jazz. That's what we have been dealing with. That's been our topic and our theme for this show. And we hope you found out something you didn't know. We hope you heard something you'd never heard before in terms of this wonderful music. This wonderful jazz music, and particularly in the area of vibes.
Outstanding.
Even starting with, you know, what vibes really are.
Yeah. It's something that, you don't think about it until somebody mentions it.
Right.
And then it's like, what is a vibraphone anyway?
Right. And a lot of people don't know they have motors.
Yeah.
Thank you for being with us on Riffin' on Jazz. We're going to go out with a tune by Bobby Hutcherson. That is the time signature, apparently.
Yeah.
Because it's called 8-4 beat. And thanks to Herbert Thomas, we learned what that is.
And, you know, it's so appropriate, like you said, you know, so go out with the up-tempo thing, and this is up-tempo. This is Bobby Hutcherson clowning on vibes.
Totally, totally. Yeah. Get back with us. We'll be back next week, same time, same place. And be sure to go to your local convenient podcast provider, or Kudzukian Media on YouTube when you search it, and get back with us and listen to some past Riffin' on Jazz shows.
Right on.
I'm Howard Robertson.
Malvin Massey here.
We'll be back. Thank you.
Jazz. Executive produced by Kudzukian. Co-host by Howard Robertson and Malvin Massey Jr. Music curation by Howard and Malvin. And recorded at Kudzukian Studios. Riffin' on Jazz. Part of the Kudzukian Network.